Okay, so we have time for one more round for those who want and have. You did yours, right?
Right.
Okay, all right. So that would take us right back to the beginning. If you are interested, a selection from Brian. Okay.
We're practicing. Why waste the time, right? The adults were talking about the village's plans for the Simons estate. The renovation of Simon's mansion might bring significant changes to the village, and that excited Steve. People do come here to fish, but that's our only real industry, Steve said. Opening Simon's mansion to the public would give people more reasons to visit us. Classical piano fans are a minority, Darlene said. That won't bring people in. Sure it will, if the village plays up the ghost story, Steve said. Brian sat up straighter. People won't fall for it, Darlene insisted. They will, and the village board intends to capitalize on it, Steve said. Munsonville hasn't progressed much in a century, so you almost can't blame them. Why don't you believe the stories, Brian asked. I've worked all over the grounds and have never seen or heard anything. Brian persisted. Then why do people say there's a ghost? People invent stories when circumstances are unclear. John Simons abruptly left town, leaving behind a huge estate and no heir, so people speculate. Ghost stories are more fascinating than truth, which, sad to say, can be boring. Of course, Steve winked again at their mother. The kids can make it exciting for the centennial. A ghost is exciting. Brian would not give up. The ghost is legendary, not historical. Melissa, maybe you'd like to write about John Simons. He's a significant part of Munsonville's history. Melissa politely nodded her head, but she had no interest in Munsonville history, its dead musician, or the mansion, only her father's connection to them. If John Simons didn't leave his estate to anyone, Melissa said, how did my dad get it? Steve corrected her. Your father had only the mansion and part of the grounds. The village owned the rest. Because of private interest, it was impossible to develop a full-scale tourist plan. It's only recently we discovered the owner. He smiled at her mother. I'm sure glad we did. Brian wrinkled his nose and gagged. Melissa nudged him with her elbow, but she glanced at her mother and Steve. That's how her father had smiled, and she didn't appreciate it on this man's face. To Melissa's annoyance, her mother smiled back. Melissa shifted uncomfortably. Steve noticed, and his smile faded. One last thing, Steve said. The place is full of bryony. John Simons was a fool to plant that weed all over his house and estate. It's a nuisance for me, but that's an artist for you. In the meantime, stay away from any plant you can't identify. Is bryony valuable? Melissa asked. So bryony was the vine she had noticed. No, it's poisonous. Steve tipped his glass to finish the iced tea, and his eyes fell on his watch. Gosh, I'm sorry. I didn't realize it was late. That's quite all right, Darlene said. We've enjoyed the company. I'll walk you to your truck. Kids, please clear off the table. As her mother and Steve moved away, Melissa heard Steve say, it's not right, you and the kids staying alone in the woods. Melissa collected the glasses. Brian stood with his hands in his pockets. You could help, Melissa said irritably. Mom wasn't just talking to me, you know. Why not write about the ghost? It's still part of the mansion's history. Steve said a ghost is not history, it's legend. Melissa headed for the kitchen. Can you at least open the door? Brian absently turned the knob. It might become history. Look at what you saw. Steve told you what I saw. Cold and warm air mixing. And you believe him? Steve lives here. I guess he knows what's by the lake. Be quiet. Mom's coming. Her mother moved slowly. Her face looked wan. She had an early morning meeting at Village Hall, too. Melissa hated housework. She knew what her father would say. So she hugged her mother, forced a smile, and said, get some sleep, Mom. I'll clean up. Her mother, face softening with relief, kissed Melissa on the forehead and headed to her room. Brian darted off before Melissa could order him into duty. Brothers. Melissa scraped leftover food into the tiny garbage can underneath the sink. It would need emptying twice a day, but so what? That was Brian's job. She peered through the window, but night blocked her view. She only saw her mother's wedding ring on the sill. Detergent residue irritated her mother's skin, so her mother always removed her ring before washing dishes. Once, her mother had knocked the ring down the drain, and Laura's dad had spent an entire afternoon fishing it out. The soap's foam reminded Melissa of mist, and she shook her head to clear the unpleasant memory. As she soaked the silverware and washed the plastic plates, her mind roamed back to the last night at Pizza Express. "Tell us about your famous musician," Kimberly Whitney had said, her blue eyes gleaming with uncharacteristic interest. She had always claimed not to wear contacts, but Melissa knew she was lying. Nobody had eyes that clear. In hushed, dramatic tones, Shelley Gallagher had told how John Simons had fallen in love with 17-year-old Bryony Marsales, daughter of Munsonville's minister, and had built the mansion in the woods as his wedding present to her. John had also covered the house and filled the estate with pink-flowered bryony, specially bred for his wife. "Isn't that so romantic?" Shelley had sighed. She was the same age as us. Laura Jones had been gawking at Jason, and she blushed and giggled into her pop when he noticed. "Melissa's lucky." Then she stole another peek at Jason. Melissa dug through the boxes for a towel, still not feeling lucky. She had just dried the last cup when Scooter barked, and she shushed him, wondering what he wanted. Scooter ran to the living room, so Melissa hung up the towel and followed him to the screen door where he stood whining. She peered into Brian's room, but her brother was sleeping. Melissa didn't see the leash. Scooter had better not run off. Melissa opened the patio doors. The overwhelming silence struck her, so different from Grover's Park. There, Melissa often heard cars driving past her house or neighbors talking in their backyards. Here, millions of stars filled the sky, and the moon glowed with golden brilliancy. Her heart beat fast with indescribable yearning. Scooter was almost back to the screen door when he stopped, turned around, and froze. His eyes locked onto the woods beyond him. He growled, a low, menacing growl. Melissa strained her eyes but saw nothing. "Silly dog," she scolded him. "It's probably just a rabbit." Once inside, Melissa refilled Scooter's water and food bowl, then ready for bed, deliberately ignoring the blank walls of her new room. Tomorrow, they would have brand new shelves, and she would stack all her books. Then would it feel like home? Melissa switched off the overhead light, felt her way to the nightstand, and groped for her little purple reading light. Propped on her pillow was a ragged, hardbound book, Nocturnal Lore, The Collected Tales of Henry Matthews. Obviously, her mother had found it in the cottage and left it for Melissa. Burrowing under the covers, Melissa opened the book, wrinkling her nose at its moldy smell. She quickly became engrossed in Flee Into Dawn, a story about a young widow who slept each night on her husband's grave despite the sexton's persistent warning, "Don't squander it on the dead." She blinked several times, but her eyelids grew heavy. She yawned, determined to find out what happened to the woman, and carefully turned a crumbling page. She awoke with her head on the book. In the distance was the faint tinkling of piano music. Melissa slid the book under her pillow and turned off the light.